Good afternoon to all of you. I have the privilege and the pleasure to be in the company of two extremely fine surgeons. I could call them doyens of cardiac surgery in our country. The first person I'd take the privilege to introduce is Professor K. M. Cherian, who actually does not need any introduction to our Society of Cardiac Surgeons. He is probably one who has the first done, have been there, done that for almost every lesion that we can think of, and in the context of this transplant meeting, he is to the credit of the second transplant in the country, the first pediatric heart transplant, the first lung transplant, the heart lung transplant. So I think the list is you know, it's endless. And to his right is Professor Iyer, who has been a mentor to a lot of us in our generation. And if I am not wrong, there's this dais probably represents correctly a Hindi movie called Kal Aaj or Kal. So I would probably start off by asking Dr. Cherian, you are the person with which probably pediatric cardiac surgery, or as that matter cardiac surgery, took birth in India, and you've seen the journey, and you're probably seeing the journey as it is maturing. So would you throw some light on how things started off in the good old days when you came back from all that training that you had to, you were brought back to India for starting this?
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here and privilege having the company of one brilliant surgeon, young brilliant surgeon, and Iyer, who is a good friend of mine for a long time. Now, I was just discussing with them, 1975, on June 6th, I came back to this country, leaving my resident status in Australia and US, where I was drawing a salary of about $68,000 in the University of Cincinnati, the Children's Hospital. Came back to India and I didn't have a job, to be honest. The only place I got was Railway Hospital. And the Railway Hospital, there was my namesake. There was Dr. T.J. Cherian, who was the medical superintendent. And he was very keen to start cardiac surgery in railways. And we did not have any infrastructure. And I always say that you have to be at the right place, at the right time, with the right people. I think this is what has been for me, to reach this position of having been recognized by others. On June 6th, I came back. That was a Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Monday morning, we had the opportunity to do an open heart surgery, just closure of simple hole in the heart. But that was a major thing, because there was nobody who knew how to run a heart lung machine. Signal and telecommunication technician from ICF, that is Integral Coach Factory, who was trained how to keep the level of blood. He was the one who was running the pump. And Dr. Kalyan Singh, he had some experience in cardiac anesthesia during his MD in CMC Hospital, Vellore. And Dr. M. Shankaran, who had never seen a cardiac surgery except some closed heart surgery or lung surgery. He was my assistant in the sense, second surgeon. So we did the first ASD closure, even though ASD closure was done first time in Bombay by Dr. K. N. Dastur, using a heart-lung machine which was indigenously made. During that time, Dr. Gobinath did a VSD closure in CMC Hospital, Vellore. And the same time, using what we call the inflow occlusion technique, an ASD was closed by Dr. PKSN in KEM Hospital. So this was the start of surgery. And I still remember it was after a week, we had a young patient, Mr. Kaja Moidi. He was 42. He had a critical left LAD branch, LAD block, and which we bypassed using a piece of saphenous vein, not knowing the fact that this was the first coronary artery bypass surgery in the country. It went off well. Only on Monday, I came to know that this was the first bypass surgery in the country. So that is why I said you should be at the right place at the right time with the right people. Right people who encourages you. Right place where you get things whatever is possible at that time, crude. But now the most important thing is pediatric cardiac surgery. When you come to the question of pediatric cardiac surgery, we again had the opportunity of doing the pediatric cardiac surgery in infants. In Vellore, up to the age of 10, or it was weight criteria, up to 15 kilos. Below that, it was not operated. We were the first people to operate on kids, and even then, the first case which we did was a VSD closure in a 4 kilo kid. So we did a series of cases, 11 cases without any mortality. Why? We had help from Sydney, Royal Alexandra Hospital for Children. They sent an anesthetist and a perfusionist. And we timed the surgical procedures because we didn't have anybody, we did not have a cardiology. There was no DM cardiology in this country. We had Dr. John Noetzi, who was a visiting professor because under Colombo plan to All India Institute of Medical Science. I requested him to come and spend 3 days with us. So Dr. John Noetzi was the pediatric cardiologist. So we made use of that and did these 11 kids, which had tetralogy, VSD, TAPVC, etc., etc. Luckily, there was no mortality because anesthesia was perfect, perfusion was perfect, diagnosis was right, and we were lucky that the post-op care was looked after by them. So we could do the first series of the infant surgery where we went down even up to 3.2 kilos. I think that was a major breakthrough as far as this country is concerned. And I came to Delhi to present that. And unfortunately, I got involved in an accident in Shirpur, Kagasnagar, because I couldn't afford airfare. Railway will not give that. My salary was only 1071 rupees. So I got involved in that train accident. But again, I'm lucky. Again, as I say, right time, right people, and right support. Nobody believes the fact that I did 8 amputations in Sirpur Kagasnagar Primary Health Center and saved at least 8 people. So this is all nothing. Nobody is brilliance or excellent work. I believe it is providential. So otherwise I need not have come back to this country at all. The reason I am saying is I was just telling both of them. In September, I had a enforcement directorate raid. Even though I had my green card in my pocket and permanent resident status in Australia, I didn't go back. Because unfortunately or fortunately, whatever it is, I had this passion. Passion was more than my monetary or any other gains. So I think that is my story.
Yeah, hearing that gives me goosebumps, and I'm probably fortunate. This generation is fortunate to have the giant shoulders on which we are standing, and probably feeling proud at this moment. Probably I would address my next question to Dr. Iyer. He has also seen a significant part of this journey, especially if we talk about the northern part of the country. He has a vast experience from public sector in AIMS and then going into private sector, as currently he's at Escorts Hospital. With a booming population in our country and a significant percentage of incidence of congenital heart procedures, what used to be rare survivors or lucky few, you know, lucky few who survived surgeries in those times, as sir is pointing out, in the 1970s, 80s, even in the Western world, and currently 85% of probably those all comers are going to survive. And now survival and probably quality of life is an expectation rather than just you know, something that we are hoping for. It's, we are actually looking at that, the patient's expectation is higher. So there is this group of people who are now surviving either naturally or now so modified natural history. What is the main problem that you see that future generation of pediatric cardiac surgeons or cardiac surgeons in as such are going to foresee? Because now we have a different population looking at us.
Thank you, Dr. Raja Joshi. And in the process, we haven't introduced you yourself, and it's a pleasure to have you interviewing us. You're the younger generation of cardiac surgeons. Dr. Raja Joshi is the chief pediatric surgeon at Sir Gangaram Hospital. Your question is very pertinent in the sense that if you look at the 70s, 80s, 90s and the 2000s, the entire scenario of congenital heart surgery in this country has changed for the better. So from the times when Dr. Cherian started this venture, when neonatal infant cardiac surgery was just a budding specialty, we've reached a stage where there are many, many centers in the country which are actively doing neonatal and infant cardiac surgery with good outcomes. But having said that, we are still in the situation where the supply is far short of the demand. And in today's scenario, we're probably barely touching 10 to 15% of the children who actually require cardiac surgery. So we have, are in this unique situation where we have children who got operated in time, the children who come for surgery probably not at the optimal time, and there's a whole population which has remained unoperated and which remained. So the current generation of cardiac surgeons has to be trained not only to deal with children who are coming on time, the children who have been diagnosed in utero and come at the time of birth. At the same time, they got to be adept in treating children who have come late in the natural history, or what we call as late presenters, and even those adults who come with untreated congenital heart disease. At the same time, what we are seeing now is the patients who have got operated in the 70s, 80s, and all of us like Dr. Cherian and all would have patients who are coming back now 30 years, 40 years, 50 years after their surgery, initial surgery, with either residual problems or newfound problems, or many patients who have surgeries which require multiple stages. So for example, you put an artificial tube or a conduit in a child at 5 years of age, as he grows, that's going to require change. So the current day generation of surgeons would have to face not only patients coming for the first time with their disease, but patients who are requiring second surgeries, third surgeries, which obviously becomes more challenging. And then patients who go into what we call as end stage heart failure, because they have a lesion which is not completely corrected or they have residual defects. And that's the area, or that's the population which is now going to keep increasing in numbers, is the patients who have operated congenital heart disease with progressive heart disease, and which finally the treatment that they would require is only possibly heart or heart-lung transplantation. So that's how the scenario has changed over the course of years.
Yes, I think that's very important message for the budding surgeon to embrace not just the pediatric perspective of heart problems, but also looking into meeting the expectation of the corrected or uncorrected adult with a congenital heart problem. I'm going to come back to you, sir. If you can remember, I'm sure you do remember. Can you share some experience with the transplants that you had in the past? Because that will put things in perspective of this conference.
Well, see, when we talk about transplant, you know, it is very important that brain death should be legalized. I'm glad to say that we in Chennai took the initiative for legalizing brain death. That was in 1991, the first meeting. That time Dr. Srinivasan, R. Srinivasan, was the health secretary, union government health secretary. He asked me, why don't you have a meeting of all the important people in Chennai and find out. So we had a meeting, and subsequently the same type of meeting was done in East, that is in Calcutta, Bombay, and ultimately in Delhi. And the bill was passed by both the houses, and brain death legalization came into. But the pediatric transplant, I think we had the opportunity to do that mainly because the transplant, that is the first the attempt by the Tamil Nadu government to have an official body which will control the donor and the recipient, you know, the list. That happened after we did the first pediatric transplant, and the donor was a young boy, 17-year-old boy by name Hidendra. His father was a doctor, Dr. Ashokan. Mother was a doctor, Dr. Pushpanjali. They came forward and said, we will give the organ. And there was a girl who was 10 years old, waiting for transplant, where we had done the first stem cell application, but after 4 months it failed. So we had the opportunity to do that girl. She was 10 years old, and that is how we started it. Then subsequently we have done 7 or 8 pediatric transplant. But the problems of pediatric transplant, I think I should not talk about it because that is too highly technical. We have a talk later on. I don't want to talk about HLA typing or you know, the donor antigen, you know, all those things. But what is important is what happens to these kids when they grow up. Do the heart grows? And what happens to the body relationship ratio between the heart and the body surface? So I'm glad to say that, you know, if the transplant is done below the age of 1, that is neonatal period, the expectancy of survival is 19.6%. If it is between 1 and 5, it is almost 16%. If it is between 5 and 10, it is almost 15%. So, you know, a retransplant is necessary, you know, and that also can be safely done because we have again the experience of doing a retransplant, and that girl is doing 2 years after retransplant where she had the first transplant which was done 9 years ago. So there are a lot of things as far as the pediatric transplant is concerned, but what is important to me is that the donor organ availability is very scarce. Where are we going to do it? So we should have ways and means of making our own solid organs, which does not need immunosuppression. And that is what we are working on. Let me take this opportunity to request the Government of India, the Department of Science and Technology, etc., to help all those people who want to have scientific evidence to show that solid organs could be made in this country at a very low cost. And that is where we say, make the medical care affordable. and it will be Make in India. And that is what we are looking for, and that is what the future, I think, as far as transplant is concerned.
Oh, that's again an eye opener. What I gather from this is that we need to have political sort of support or will. We need to make the society a little more aware that the organs are better utilized out here. And number three is that surgical society has to brace up with the training part. So coming to the training part, Dr. Iyer, if I can ask you to touch base on that, what are you think the, not from just training point of view, if a program wants to start off doing transplants, what are the hospitals or the overall prerequisites that may be required before they venture out into something as adventurous as transplants?
As Dr. Cherian mentioned, and as I would say, transplant technically is a fairly straightforward operation. For most congenital heart surgeons, there are far more complicated procedures that they do on a daily basis than a transplant. The issues with transplant are multiple. One, of course, is the legal issues, the question of legally getting an organ harvested and transported. So there is a whole lot of bureaucracy involved in the actual certifying of brain death, harvesting of organs, who is legally capable of harvesting organs, who is recognized for that, and then making sure that there is nothing happening underhand in the utility of these organs and all. So that system has to be in place, and that's where the state machinery comes into play. And that's where the southern states have taken a much greater leap forwards in that, in organizing that system. That's why if you see today that the transplants teams are more active in the southern states than in the northern states. This one. The second aspect, of course, is the training aspect, that once the hospitals themselves take up the challenge, then I think that's a less difficult component of the whole system of doing a transplant. But I think the more is the logistics of organizing a transplant program as such, and to which the government has a big role to play.
True. So I think that's before we embark on programs like that, we need to step up to understanding the needs and the requirements as prerequisites for all that. I think having additional support from other solid organ transplants, because pediatric transplants are now embarking on multi-organ requirements, if you want to throw light on the need.
Yes, increasingly, as you mentioned, that for the pediatric population, one of the greatest needs for transplant of the patient population that requires transplants is those end-stage heart disease following palliative surgery. That's the Fontan circulation of patients with single ventricle who undergo the Fontan. And unfortunately, when they go into end-stage heart failure, it's not just a single heart failure component, but they also have, in addition, most of them have cirrhosis of the liver. So they have end-stage liver problems, and some of them even have kidney problems. So just transplanting their heart or heart lung is not going to solve the problem. They also need additional support for the liver in terms of the liver transplant often. So the trend towards now in the United States, where they have the maximum experience, is this, is patients requiring a combined heart, heart lung plus a liver transplant, which becomes a huge venture, becomes a joint effort. But there will be a fairly large number of patients who will probably require this, considering the number of patients of single ventricle who are undergoing these sort of palliative procedures. So going down, looking into the future, we are going to feel the need for these sort of procedures to be developed and encouraged.
I think that is what from our desk we have to share. And again, I would thank Dr. Cherian and Dr. Iyer, both of you, to have shared your thoughts with us. And I hope that is a good learning for all the viewers. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.